Goedenachtmiddag. Ich spreche ein bisschen Deutsch, aber I will do this presentation in English. And if the people in the back can't hear me, please join here. I will do a presentation about the Linux command line. I'm Peter Martin. I live in Nijmegen. It's in the Netherlands. It's here. It's pretty far away. And I'm not really fond of Windows. I really love Linux. If you use Windows, I don't mind. It's just a tool, just like Linux or Mac. But in 2007, I switched to Debian, to Ubuntu, and then to Debian. And this machine, I did a presentation about this. I think it was in Nuremberg. It's a Raspberry Pi, and you can use the Raspberry Pi as a server or as a computer, and it runs on Linux. I learned this machine learned me a lot about command line magic. And if you don't have the stuff, this is really nice to experiment with. You probably have something like this, not at home, of course, but you use a server somewhere. And if you have SSH access to your server, you can do a lot of stuff that's really difficult to do when you don't have it. In this presentation, I will give you some commands that you can use. I will tell about the basics of Linux, how to connect to a computer, a little bit about scripts, backups, and I will end up with virtual environments. Who in this room is using Unix or Linux already? Okay, and who is doing scripts? Okay, cool, yeah. Okay, first of all, Linux is a cross-platform operating system. The Raspberry Pi is using an ARM processor. You can use it on the Intel processor, and there are a lot of different processors that you can use Linux on. If people talk about Linux, it can be about two things. It's about the kernel. It's a sort of layer between the hardware and programs, like the Linux kernel does things with the CPU and with the RAM, etc. It's just the kernel. But sometimes people talk about Linux and they talk about Ubuntu as Linux. Ubuntu is Linux, but it's a distribution with the Linux kernel. In a distribution, a lot of choices are made. So if you, for instance, install Arch Linux, it's a really small Linux version, and you have to install everything you want to use on this machine. Personally, I use Debian because I'm used to it, but I will tell you something about it. Linux was made by Linus Torvalds. He is a Swedish guy, he studied in Finland, and he used Minix. But Minix is a sort of Unix, but it was not really free, and he wanted to have a free operating system on his 386. So he was doing a hobby project called Freyax, but some of the webmasters, they didn't like the name, and they renamed it to Linux, and then he said, okay. So it's called Linux now. It's really popular. There are a couple of reasons, because first of all, it's open source. It's free and free of charge. It's really stable, just like Unix. It's multi-user, so multiple people can use the same computer on the same time, and it's multitasking, so they can use multiple programs at the same time. And there's a sort of dependency system in it. There are a couple of different variants. The Debian family, you have the Red Hat. Those are backed by commercial companies. Here in Germany, OpenSUSE is really popular. And of course, you have Gentoo, Arch Linux, and Android. The commands you can use with Linux, they are pretty much Unix commands, so you can use them in Unix as well, probably, most of the time. And macOS is also Unix, so you can just fire the terminal, but I'll tell you that later. First, some basics. Who uses Windows? Who has used MS-DOS in the past? Okay. Linux is a sort of MS-DOS kind of shell. You have a sort of shell, but you also have a GUI. when I talk about Linux in this presentation, it's just the shell, so it looks like MS-DOS. In MS-DOS, you could use commands like dir, which make you can see all the files in the directory. The basic commands of Linux are the man command, with man, which means manual. You can ask for a manual. So man will give you the manual of the man command. Instead of dir, you will use ls, meaning list. And there are also other things like list USB, so you can list all the USB devices connected to your device. And if you're talking about files and folders, creating a directory is really easy with the command make dir, mkdir, and removing is rm. To go to a directory, from one directory to another, you do cd, which means change directory. And the tilde is your home folder, but I will tell you in a minute. Concatenate, get, is just to view a file. And if you want to edit a file, you can use something like nano. And people who are really hardcore, they will laugh now, because you are using VI or Vim. I don't mind, it's just a tool. And I find Vim too difficult. To copy stuff, you use the copy command. And if you want to move stuff or rename stuff, the move command, mv. And maybe you want to remove a whole directory with all contents, you can use the rm command, but this is really, really dangerous. Really dangerous. So before you ever do this, do the same with the ls command. Or maybe there is some sort of extra flag, an extra option that you can use with rm, and I think it will just simulate it. But be careful. When you work with Joomla, with file managers, you have permissions. We all know that a Joomla website has 755 and for folders and 644 for files, except the configuration, which should be, I think, 600. 444, okay, thanks. Yeah. But if you want to change it, you can use the change mod command. And ownership, every file has an owner. You can change it with chown, the chown command. So let's go to the basics of Linux. The most important thing of Linux, and this is really important, everything is a file or a file block. And I think the name Linux is not good. They should have named it Files or Earth or something like that, because everything is in file. You can even look at the processes running on your computer. So they're in memory, they're not real files, but with Linux, you can look them if there are files. And because everything is a file, even folders are files, but sort of special files that don't have any contents except other files, you can give permissions and you have ownership. If your user creates a file, your user will be the owner. Your user is also in a group. So the group also have a sort of access on the file. And you have also to set something like public. And maybe this will explain it. If you look at the files, you will probably see a couple of flags in front of it. The R is 4. The W is 2, and the execute, the X, is 1. So 7 means they're all set. So if you have files on your website called and they have permission 777, you're not really good. This is dangerous, because every your owner, the group, and public has read, write, execute access. So this is how you have to read that. If you are working on a computer, on a Linux system, you are probably a regular user. If you look at the command line, you will see something like your username, then the @, and then your computer name. And if you are a normal user, you will have a dollar sign as a prompt. If you are a root user, the root can do everything, so I can do anything, then you will have you will be called root, and you will have the hashtag. And with the command who am I, you can see which user you are. You can change user by doing SU, means switch user. And because it's really difficult. So if you want to install stuff, you have to be root, or use a command like sudo. And sudo means do this command with a switch user or something. So if you have little children or babies, maybe you know this cream. If I see something sudo, I always think about sudo cream. It's for the babies with the red buttocks. But you can run commands using the sudo command, so you don't have to switch to the su. The tilde is a special sign. If you use a tilde in something, like cd tilde, you will go to the root folder of the user you are. So I am Peter, and my home folder is called slash home slash Peter. If I am a root user, then the tilde will refer to slash home slash root. And if I am something else, then it will be home slash something else. To output stuff to a file or to some other program, you can use the greater than symbol. So you can create a list of all your documents in your current folder just by doing ls greater than and then the name of a file, and then the file will be created. And if you do it two times, so two times greater than it will be appended to another file. The pipe is really powerful. With the pipe, you can do two commands in a row. They will be connected to each other. So if you have a folder which has really a lot of files, and you will do ls, it will scroll out of the screen. If you do pipe less, then you get screens, and you can just scroll up and down. Something else, maybe you have a really long list of stuff in your configuration, and you want to see the password of your Joomla website. Grep will show the line with the information on it. So cat configuration will just print everything, but with the pipe it will only display the line with the contained password. Because everything's files, you have also symbolic things, symbolic links. So maybe you have a website somewhere and you want to do stuff with it. You can use the LNS to create symbolic links. On Windows, it's called shortcuts, and you can do it in Linux like this. If you create extensions, you can use this for your extensions. For instance, on GitHub, you create your extension, you check it out in a folder, and in your Joomla website, on the places where files should appear, you can just create symbolic links. So in your administrator folder, slash component, slash components, you can put your symbolic link to your own component folder, which is in another folder. And if you do something with Git, you just can do it easily from one directory. So the connecting stuff. If you do something with computers and connecting, you will see the command tty. TTY is the terminal, and it's because of in the past they had teletypewriters, meaning you had here you had a keyboard, and at some other location you had a printer which would print the stuff you would type on the keyboard. Windows, you have to install PuTTY, and the TTY is also in the name. Windows 10, I was told that it should have something called the PowerShell, which is should contain SSH. I'm not sure if it's really there already. Mac has a built-in terminal, and Linux also has a terminal. And if you want to connect to another computer, you can use Telnet. Who uses Telnet? Don't use it. Because SSH is the thing you have to use. With Telnet, Telnet is just like FTP, or like normal email without TLS. If you do something with Telnet or FTP, you will communicate the password and all the data just at normal text over the line. If you use SSH or you use FTP over SSH, it's all encrypted. It uses public key cryptography. And if I want to connect to another computer, I just use SSH, then the username, at and then the number of the computer. And if my username here is also Peter, I don't have to put Peter in front of it. But because my username on this server is different from this computer, I have to add pi at. So this is what you do with a computer. The first time you will get something like this. This is to protect the man-in-the-middle attack. What if you want to connect to a computer like Joomla.org, and you connect to a computer who says, yeah, I'm Joomla.org, but it is not Joomla.org. It's hacker.org, which connects to Joomla.org, and you connect to a hacker, and you think it's Joomla. So then you have a bad situation. So if you connect for the first time to a server, make sure that the fingerprint in this place is the same as it should be. And you should ask your hosting provider or look at their website, and they should have a key. And if it's not the same, I would not dare to log in. If you have to log in a lot, you can create a keyless, a key pair, and then you can have a keyless login, so passwordless login. I don't dig into this. So, scripts. And this is really powerful. I mean, you can do a lot with GUIs, but if you use scripts, you can automate tasks, and computers are to automate tasks. So you can automate tasks with input and output, which are variables. And you can also do it automatically by creating cron tabs. If you are creating scripts, then you are creating shell scripts or bash scripts. Who creates shell scripts? And who bash? And who dash? Okay. Oh, yeah. Shell is the original shell. And if you look at shell scripts, it says something like this. They call it shebang/bin/sh. Currently, these days, it's replaced by bash, and it's a joke because it's a born-again shell. It has more features than the normal shell, the old shell. And if you have this in your script, it still works because this is a symbolic link to the bash. And if you use Debian or Ubuntu, you might have seen dash. When I see it, I always think about this washing detergent. It's also here in Germany, I know. Dash dry. I'm not really sure when I use it, but I know it's there, and I think it's only used for when you are starting up your computer. But I just use bash. So an example of a really tiny script. You start with shebang bin bash. Then here I declare a string called hello Joomla. And here I just echo it. And the hashtag is commands. This is really simple. I should have done hello world, but this is better. Something you can do is backing up. You can create backups using Akiba backup or other stuff. Xcloner, I think. But you can also use the command line to create backups using rsync. Rsync is remote synchronization. And it's more powerful than copy, because with copy, you copy a whole block of information to another server. And with rsync, you only copy the parts that have been changed. So if you have a really large file, and only a couple of bits have been changed, only the bits are communicated to the other side. And this is what you can do to synchronize one server to a local machine. This is only backing up files. And of course, you have to back up your database as well. Really simple with MySQL dump. And if you have a MySQL dump, you can just use MySQL as command to import this dump into another MySQL database. In the past, and I'm thinking about maybe 2007, 2006, maybe 2008, I sometimes had really huge scripts, MySQL scripts. Maybe the largest was 64 gigabyte, or megabyte. But there is a problem if you want to import such a large of SQL data if you use PHP MyAdmin. And then I discovered a really great script called MySQL dump, I think it's. No. Big dump. Yes, that's one. I think from a Russian guy. And it's marvelous because you can really, it does it automatically for you. But when I discovered the command line, this is really easier because just import it like this. I told you that Linux is just files, and if you think about files, you probably need to find files. You want to find where something happens and you want to find the files. There are a couple of ways to search for files. The easiest command is find. It's also very slow. Locate is much more faster, but it will use a database. All the files will be indexed in a database, but it will, I think, automatically be done once a day. And if you have recent files, you won't find it. So, or you have to update the database of the locate function and then do locate. But I mostly use find, even if it's slow. I just drink coffee or something else. Where is? You can find the binaries or the manuals, and which will return the path name of a file. So, what if you are, maybe you want to know where your configuration.php is. Well, of course, that's a stupid example because it's in the root. But for instance, if you want to find it, you use the word find, then the location where it should start the search, and then the name, and this is just the name of the whole file I want to know, to find. This is not really practical, but this is just an example. A practical example would be, you have probably clients. Those clients upload files, and sometimes some things don't work anymore because the hosting, it's reached its limits of hard disk space. And you want to help your client and to find the biggest files, just to remove those so they can continue doing the stuff. With this command, you can find the 15 the biggest files. First, you have the find command. And here is a pipe. It will sort those. And it will only show the top 15. So if you do something on a server and you want to know the things that have been changed in the last couple of days, you can use the find with the F. And then, all the files. I don't want to see directories, only files. And then the files that have been created the last 7 days, or which have been changed last. Did I mix them up? Oh, yay. Could be. You have M time, you have C time. One is changed, and the other is created. Or maybe modified and changed. Okay, sorry. Maybe you can cut this out of the presentation and just do it again. So again, this is changed. It says created, but it should be changed. And this is created, modified. Oh, no. Never mind. You have to try it yourself. Of look on in the manual, men find. So what if you have a customer and they have a Joomla website and they have images in the Joomla website? The website is maybe 5 years old. And a lot of articles have been removed already. There are a lot of files still on the hard drive, still on the server. And you want to get rid of those. What could you do? Well, and René Krijveld, he's from Holland, he wrote a script called jfindfiles. This script will create an SQL dump. And then it will find all the files in SQL dump and compare those files with the files in your images folder. And then you will see all the files that are not really used anymore. So you know what to, yeah, sort of. Why are you nodding? Yes. And maybe some images are in all the folders like media or your template. That could be, but it helps you a bit. You have to be, you should not automatically delete everything. Create a backup first. And I already showed you how to create a backup. And it's really it's important to create backups. Who has had this problem on this website? Only one. Okay, me too. if you have a client, because we all update our websites, but if you have a client who has been hacked, there are a couple of steps you have to take. First of all, you have to backup the current situation. You have to create a backup to the current situation because you want maybe to refer to the situation again, or maybe use it for some other stuff. Then you have to copy the log files of your server to a safe place and analyze those. Especially if, when you know when a site is hacked, you have to look in the log files to see what commands were used, what post commands were used, and then you might find a vulnerability. And of course, you have to clean the files. So what can you do? Well, maybe you know that the site has been hacked the last 10 days, because 11 days ago there was nothing, everything was working, and 10 days ago it started to become weird. So what you have to do is you can use the find command. Yeah? You can find the last 10 days, except files and dates can be modified. Last year, a site of one of my sites got hacked, and there was one file, a hacker file, that was maybe 3 years old. And I thought, oh, that I did, I've never seen this file. Wait a minute, that's weird. And then I was looking at all the backups I had, and then in maybe a backup of 2 months ago, I noticed that one day it was not there, and one day later it was there. But the file was 3 years old and not 2 months, so this was weird. So this is not all working all the time. You can also look for special signatures, like the infamous EVIL or BASE64 decode. If you have these kinds of commands, PHP commands in your files, you maybe it's very suspicious. However, the hacker who hacked my website concealed it by using a string with preg replace. And if you translate this, it would be preg replace EVIL BASE64 decode. But you can't find it because it's not there. And if you would scan for this signature, they would just add another bracket, or maybe 2, 3, 4 brackets, and the string would be different. So not really that. Fortunately, there is someone and who created a script called NeoPy. I like it, not because of the Raspberry Pi and Pi, but this is really awesome, this script. You have to have Python installed on your server. You can clone it just from GitHub, and you can run it by starting it. Sometimes maybe you have to put a dot in front of it, or you have to make it executable. And then you have to add some commands after it, and the folder it should scan. It will scan all the files, and it will show you top 10 lists of the suspicious files, so the really long files, or files with a lot of weird characters in it. And it will help you to find suspicious files, but most of the files are just normal files, but they are just suspicious. Then the last part. Sometimes you don't want to use a server, an external server or a Raspberry Pi, but you have your computer and you want to do stuff with servers or practice with servers and just on your computer. What you can do is use VirtualBox. Who uses VirtualBox? Okay, who uses VMware? And why VirtualBox and VMware? I see some. Why? Why both? Oh, different projects, different. Okay. Well, I use VirtualBox, and if you use VirtualBox, you have to download it for your system. You have to start it, and then you can install an operating system in it. For instance, an ISO of Debian, and it takes a lot of time, maybe half an hour to install it. Then you have it. You can create a snapshot, and you can go back to the snapshot all the time. But another thing is you can use Vagrant. Anyone using Vagrant over here? Okay, cool. With Vagrant, it's a sort of wrapper around virtualization software. In this case, I use it around a virtual machine. You can download it from Vagrant up. And on Linux, on Debian, you can install it with a Debian package. With I of install, and then the name of the package. And when you install it and you use it, you need a folder, and a configuration file. The folder will serve as a sort of container where all the files will be stored. And the configuration file will be called vagrant file, and it's in the folder. Oh, sorry, yeah. This case, you can just easily set up new virtual machines, especially if you use vagrant cloud. Vagrant cloud is a sort of repository system for virtual machines. And there are a lot of virtual machines, and not only virtual machines, it are virtual machines of operating systems, and sometimes with other stuff in it, like Debian, with Apache Web Server, PHP MySQL, etc. And you can just download the packages, but you can also install them directly by doing something like vagrant-brox add chef Debian. If you have it in a folder, you can you have to initialize it. And if you have initialized it, you have a configuration file. And this configuration file, you can change some stuff, like maybe make it accessible via the 8080 port. Then you have to start it up with vagrant up. And then the box is there, but it's only there. And if you want to go into the box, you have to do vagrant SSH. And then you can do all kind of stuff, like installing Apache. Yeah, this is too difficult now. Or installing PHP. Or installing PHP MyAdmin. Or, of course, install Joomla. And with this command line, you just get Joomla from the web server, and you just install it. If you are using Vagrant, and you want to test Vagrant with different PHP versions, then you might have a difficulty. I mean, if I install Vagrant, I will put PHP 5.4 on it. But yeah, PHP 7 is just around the corner, and maybe I want to test Joomla with it. You can create a new folder, I mean a new Vagrant environment, and update the PHP version over there. But you can also do something else. It's called Linux containers, and Docker is a sort of, how do you say it, thing around it, a sort of wrapper around it. And then you can create sort of boxes. In one box you put your current operating system will be the base, and you can create a box for PHP, a box for an Apache server, a box for MySQL, and you can connect those to each other. And if you have the box of PHP, which is PHP 5.6, and you want to have PHP 7, you just bring down the box, bring up a new box with PHP 7, and if everything goes all right, it will work with PHP 7. The only thing what you should be careful with is, the database is also virtual. So if you bring down the box with the database, you destroy the database. There is one thing you can do, is you can create a database on your normal system, and just have a symlink from the box. So instead of doing it virtual, it's a real database on your machine. But yeah, that's basically it. Are there any questions? If there are not, I can show a small vagrant demo, if you want to. Yeah? Okay. Then I have to take this one. I have to switch my screen because I want to have the same screen here as there. Is no problem with that?
No problem.
Okay.
Because I write on some VGA
Okay, it's working. So I have on this machine a local host where I have some stuff on it, but maybe I want to do some new stuff and I don't want to mess up my current environment. In that case, I have to create a new folder first, this is my current folder. So now it's empty, and I have to speak my name. I already downloaded the Fragrant Box on my machine. Otherwise, I have to wait for 5 minutes, maybe. So what I just do is Fragrant init. This is the box I already downloaded. And now it says there's a Fragrant file in your folder. And it is, it's called Fragrant file. And I told you this is too much, so I can do it with less. And then I cannot even go back. In the past, people used more, but the command more only could, with the space, you could see the next screen, next screen, next screen, and you, couldn't go up again. So someone else thought, yeah, I have to change it, and he created less. And actually, less is more, so. Anyway, real Linux people will laugh at me right now. But I find this handy. So there is one, I don't know, can you see it? Yeah, this one. I will create a port on 8080. So if I go to my local host port 8080, I will see the new server in a while. So now I changed my configuration file, and now I will bring it up. And this might take 1 or 2 minutes. Meanwhile, this is my normal site, and if I go to port 80, you will see still the same site. And if I go to port 8080, there's nothing available because I don't have a web server running in this virtual machine. The port is there, but no server. And 40%, 60, okay. So when it's ready, I will use a Fragrant SSH to create, to log in into the machine. Oh, you can see here. That the port is 8080. When your Fragrant machine is up and you want to go away and do something else, you can do a couple of things. You can destroy it, but then it will take a couple of minutes again. You can suspend it, or you can halt it. Halt is closing it down completely, and suspend is just sort of sleeping mode. SSH. What you see is here is my normal machine, and now I'm user Fragrant in another machine called Debian Jesse. And I told you about installing stuff. I didn't tell you, but with apt-get in Debian, you can install stuff if you do the install command. And in this case, I need Apache. And I will get an error right now. Could not open a log file. It's because I don't have permissions to install stuff on this machine. Because I have to use sudo in front of it. On a normal Linux machine, I should get a question for what's your password. But I'm here in this machine, and now I don't get this question. It's just a virtual machine, so I'm a virtual root now. I just installed Apache without anything, so without PHP. It takes too much time. But if I go to this website, port 8080, it says Debian config. So now I have my website running, and then I can do the next stuff like installing MySQL, PHP, and actually I like Nginx better as web server than Apache, so I could do the same thing with, I will do the same thing with Nginx. So, Oh. So now I'm deinstalling Apache, and with this is just the way to install Nginx. So now I have another web server over there. Of course, this is not completely finished, because when you want to do stuff, you want to have multiple domains, and you have to create multiple virtual hosts in your Nginx. But if I do like this now, it should. This is weird. Okay. I don't think this will work now in this demo. It's always the same. So now my virtual box should say that it's saved, and with vagrant. Maybe I should have brought down the Apache server first before deinstalling it. I don't know, maybe it's still memory. But anyway. No, I can't show you this. I don't know why, but I deinstalled it. Sorry, Netscape? This is Google Chrome. Oh, sorry, no, Google Chromium. And this is Firefox on Debian. Yeah. No, it's still running. I've never experienced this before. Install Apache 2. Oh. And then is it sudo service Apache 2 stop. Okay. Now, yeah. Okay. I think this is good enough for this afternoon. Are there any questions besides how this works in this case? I will just create a new instance, new fragment instance, and I will just do it right Nginx the first time. And I don't know how this works like this.
RMRF.
Huh?
RMRF.
Remove
all. Oh, purge. Yeah, then I will use purge. Yes. Okay, thank you.